Hey guys, welcome back to my channel Mahaguru Yash Architecture Classes. So in the last video we started discussing GATE 2019 question paper and we completed it till question number 10. So let's move forward from question number 11. Okay, also I have told you that the link to this study material prepared for you all guys and me would be there in the description box below. Please take it and you will get the color PDF for this. The next question number 11 is, the term necropolis refers to what of the following? The term necropolis was given by Lewis Mumford. Okay, this word was given by Lewis Mumford in his city classification theory. So he classified city into five stages, or he gave the evolution stages of a city. So the first is ecopolis, which is a small town as a unit, as in a city at a very grassroots level. It can be a village in our context right now, and its base economy base is agriculture. The second is polis, wherein the rural area is now getting converted into an urban area, and instead of just primary sector, now you have commerce and industry, which is the primary and tertiary sector coming in. The third stage is metropolis, as in now the village has totally converted into a urban area or a city, and it has all the urban facilities of like water supply, electricity, transport, education, etc. The next stage is megapolis, wherein now, because the city has come into a metropolis and it's a full grown city, a lot of people now start commuting to the city, and this creates a lot of problems like growth, expansion, overpopulation. So in megapolis, now the city faces some problems now. The next is tyrannopolis. Now what happens is, when you have many problems, the people start moving out of the city and try to settle in a different city. This stage, the city starts to decay and people start migrating. And the last is necropolis, which is the dead city, as in all the people have left the city. And the answer for the necropolis would be C, a dead settlement. I would like to tell you that the question paper and the answer sheet and my notes would be there in the description box below. The next question is, which of the following projection type is adopted in universal transverse marketer or the UTM? This is known. The answer is cylindrical. Let us see what a UTM is. This is a UTM. So UTM, it is system of assigning. It is a system for assigning coordinates to location on the surface of the earth. Like the traditional method of latitude and longitude, it is a horizontal positional representation which means it ignores altitude and treats the earth as a perfect cylinder. That's my mistake. So what happens is, when you fold this map into curve, you get a cylinder. I have some examples for this. So this is a cylinder. There are different kinds of maps projection. The first is cylindrical projection, for which we use the UTM. What happens is, just imagine you have a rectangular sheet curved into a cylinder, and then the earth is put in it, and then you draw all the projection on the surface of the cylindrical sheet, and when you unfold it, you get the map of the world. The other projections are the conic projection, where you put in the earth in a conic, in a cone, and then you take out the projection on the floor, on the surface of the, so there you get a very, when you unwrap it, you get something like this kind of a projection. Okay, this. So you have all your latitude on this position, and the longitudes like this and the latitudes like these. The next is azimuthal equidistant projection, wherein you take half of the earth, the northern hemisphere, and you take a circle. On this circle, you try to project out all the cities. So what happens is, if let's take in this as some rectangle. So you project it upward. You project it upward, this projection, and you will get something like this here. like something I might get, this will come in. So I have all these projections. These concentric circles get smashed with these, and this is smashed with this, and then you get this kind of a, but this kind of a map. But in the present scenario, most of the projection which we follow is the cylindrical projection used for UTM, because it is very handy and easy for the normal public to understand. The next question is, the ingredient to be added to produce aerated cement concrete is aluminium, gypsum, calcium, calcium chloride or sulfur. So let us see what this all four does. Let us see what is aerated cement concrete. This is also known as autoclave. It is also known as autoclaved aerator concrete. It is a lightweight concrete foam concrete building material suitable for producing concrete masonry units. So it is composed of quartz, sand, calcined gypsum, lime, cement, water and aluminium powder. So what aluminium powder does is when it reacts, when it is autoclaved, it's a machine where the bricks are burned. So when this is burned, aluminium reacts and creates air globule. So when Al2O3 reacts, so if aluminium is produced, it creates oxygen or hydrogen bubbles in the concrete, and you get small pores of air trapped in this, which decreases your this decreases the weight of this, and you have aerated concrete. Now let's see what other three materials do. So when sulfur is added to cement, sulfur is added to concrete so that any reaction, so it becomes resistant to compounds like acid attacks and etc. Gypsum is added to control the setting time of cement. If it is not added, the cement will immediately get settled, even immediately after water is added, and you will not even get time for concrete placing. The next is calcium chloride. This is added so that the hydration rate of cement is increased. So the next question is, the cause of short column effect during seismic occurrence is due to what are the following? The options are centralized rupture of the column, tearing of reinforcement bars, buckling of column or stress concentration. So well, let us see what a short column is. So a column, those are short heighted or with shorter effective heights to that of other regular taller columns within the same story. So I have some examples given here. So you can see on a slope, this is the building. To maintain, you have extended columns, and at this level you have varying height of columns. So for the same story, you have different columns. So these are the tall columns and these are the short columns. You can see for the same story level, you have different height of columns. Even if you have on a plain ground, you have a same story and you have a beam running in, the effective length of the column is now this much. Is this much, okay? And whereas for the effective length of these columns is this. So the effect, since the effective length of this column is less due to a beam coming in between, these columns are known as short columns and these columns are known as tall columns. So what happens basically is the short columns are stiffer compared to long columns, and hence most of the earthquake forces acting on the building are taken by the short columns. More stiffer the structure element is, less the flexibility will happen. Therefore, more stress, there would be a difference in stress concentration in the tall column and the short column. Hence, the answer becomes stress concentration. Because the short columns are stiffer, they will try to take in more of the stress, and the tall columns will, because of its less stiffness, they are more flexible and take less loads. The next question is, the solar protection system consisting of fixed slats or grids outside a building facade in front of openings is known as what? Bryosolil, solarium, mulcaf or trombobole. The answer is bryosolil. Let us see the four options and discuss them in detail. What is a bryosyl? A bryosyl is a system uses a series of horizontal and vertical blades to control the amount of light. So you can see this somewhere you have a window and you have vertical blades in some angle which controls the amount of light coming in inside the room. Here only one or two blades are used, but if you use multiple blades can also be seen. In India we use this technique very frequently in hot and dry areas. The next option given was solarium. What is a solarium? A sunroom, also frequently called a solarium, is a room that permits abundant daylight and views of the landscape while sheltering from adverse weather conditions. What happens is, in cold countries, you do not get much of the heat, sunlight. So what you try to do is, whatever heat you get in, you try to trap it. So a very simple technique of greenhouse effect is used. You create a small space or a veranda or a courtyard with three or four surfaces of glass. So when the heat comes in, the air inside the room gets heated up and cannot, the air is heat and it cannot move out. Therefore, this heat can be utilized for the people. The next is Malkaf. So what is a Malkaf? It is a wind tower in traditional Iranian architectural element to create natural ventilation in buildings. Wind catchers come in various design, unidirectional, bidirectional, multidirection. So this is a wind tower and this is a cross section of the wind tower. So what happens is, you can see the space. From this side, you catch in the hot air. In this area, mostly you put in porous pots or have sprays of water. So when water sprays on this hot air, the hot air becomes cold. Now it becomes heavy and comes down. When it comes, the cold air comes in within the building. The people enjoy this cold air. There is an exchange of heat. The cold air once again becomes heated up due to men's perspiration and human body's heating. They move out. Their density decreases, move up and move out of the system. The next given option was trombe wall. So a trombe wall is a passive solar building design where a wall is built on the wind or sun side of a building with a glass external layer and a high heat capacity internal layer separated by a layer of air. So this is again used in winter countries where winter is the main season. So what is what a trombe wall basically is? You have a glass wall. In between you have air and a wall with high thermal mass, and you have two vents for the exchange of air. So what happens is, during the daytime, the glass gets heated up. So when the glass gets heated up, the air just beside it also get heated up. So the heated air now goes up there, it finds a place to move in. So you provide a vent, so the hot air comes inside, the room becomes heated up. Once the air cools down, it again goes down and come out. And again, due to the direct solar heat gain, the air again gets heated up and there is a continuous process. So if you close both the vents, you have a trapped air inside. In the morning time, you can use all the vents, opened up vent. This is known as vented trombe wall. But in the night, you do not want this air to go out. So you close these vents and it becomes an unvented trombe wall. You provide a high thermal mass wall on the other side because you do not want the heat which is accumulated within the building to move out. So these two walls would have high thermal mass. Okay, now the next question is, the Indian property inscribed by UNESCO on the World Heritage List in the year 2018. So the options here was Tanchare Palace in Ernakulam, the Victorian Gothic and Art Deco Ensemble of Mumbai, ancient Buddhist site Sarnath, and the Mughal Gardens in Kashmir. So, the answer is in the year 2018, Victorian Gothic, that is the Indo-Saracenic monuments and the Art Deco Ensemble of Mumbai was inscribed in the UNESCO World Heritage Site. So the examples of this in this would be the Gateway of India, your Chhatrapati Shivaji Mumbai Terminus, then you have the Imperial Tower Cinemas and other many other buildings. In the year 2017, so since we are discussing the UNESCO World Heritage Sites, let us discuss what all was there in the earlier years as well. In 2017, the historic city of Ahmedabad got the recognition of a UNESCO World Heritage Site. And it is the first Indian city, the first city of India to be listed in UNESCO World Heritage Site. In 2016, it was the works of Le Corbusier in Chandigarh. You can see, Chandigarh in itself did not get listed. The works which were present in Chandigarh by Le Corbusier. You have the Secretariat building, the palm statue, and the court, and etc. In the year 2015, archaeological site in Nalanda was listed. Then you can see from 15 to 2010, there were no listment. 2010, it was Jantar Mantar in Jaipur. I have given you a map of all the UNESCO World Heritage Site present in India, and then from there you can study very well. Okay, now the next question. Question number 17 says, typical features of Buddhist architecture are. So what basically comes under Buddhist architecture? Get back to your history notes. So Buddhist architecture mainly consists of stupas, where the relics of Buddha was kept, chaityas, where all the monks used to live, and the viharas, where they used to stay. So in chaityas, so this is a typical elevation of a stupa, and you can see, even if you don't know Buddhist architecture, you can use a very common basic historical knowledge, as in the first option says mandapa, chhatri, amlaka and torana. Amlaka is present in temples, the vimanas at the top, the amlaka lasha. B says sthambha, torana, vimana and harmika. Vimana is the basic structure over the garbhagriha. D says Vedika, Stupa, Chaitya and Vimana. Again, Vimana is there. Hence, the answer has to be C. Vedika, Chhatri, Torana and Harmika. Now, let us see where does it comes in. So, this is a Stupa, also known as the Vedika. You have a Harmika and a Chhatri on top. Also, you have gates which have Toranas on it. Okay? Also, Buddhist architecture was very much inspired from Greek architecture as well. That is why you have a different, very various kinds of arches found in the Buddhist period. So these are the different kinds of Buddhist architecture arches. So this is a very famous Vishwakarma trefoil arch, and this is the very famous Ajanta arch. So you can see, since we are talking about Buddhist architecture, so Buddhist architecture draws its inspiration from the wooden architecture which was there in the early times, when people did not knew how to use modern materials like stone and everything. They used to create the temples or their preaching area using wood and the hay or the grass. So you can see these small extrusions. So these extrusion basically represents the wooden sections placed horizontally. When you place horizontal sections in a curved manner, so you have your wooden section curved manner, and then you lay your wooden section this manner so that you get a curved space. Okay, so these section mainly repent. So this tells us that even if wooden architecture ended, these people used to still have their inspiration from the earlier times. The next question is, identify the queen closures. So you have different options given. So this is a queen closure. When you cut the brick longitudinally into two equal parts. So you can see, when you cut the brick in the longitudinal portion, this is the longitudinal, this is known as a queen closure. But when you slice it up in a horizontal way, you get a split. When you break it from the between, this is known as a half bat. There's a 3/4 closure, a quarter closure. And when you splice it up from the 3/4 distance here and a one, when these distances are same, this is known as king closure. Okay, so these are the different types of closure. Sorry for the spelling. I'll correct it up and put it in the, since we're discussing bricks, let us see different types of brick masonry I have given you. So this is a very famous stretcher bond, where you just use stretcher, and when you lay the another layer of stretcher, you put it in between. In a Flemish bond, you have stretcher header, the other 3/4 layers become stretcher, then again you have stretcher header. So you have different kinds of brick masonry I have given you, so please look into it and study them well. The next question is, identify the role of vermiculite in the vertical landscape. I would like to tell you that this question was cancelled and all the students were given marks because the term vermiculite is wrong. The term is vermiculite. So vermiculite and another material, perlite, are added to the garden in potting soil to increase the water retention and nutrient retention and aerate the soil, resulting in healthier and more robust plants. Okay, and this vermiculite is basically made up of hydrated laminar minerals which look like mica. I have given you a brief introduction to vermiculite as well, so please do read it. As in the video, I cannot discuss each and every point. Please look into the notes as well. The next question. Which of the following parameters is essential to estimate the envelope performance factor EPF of a building as per energy conservation code ECBC? So let us see what building envelope basically means. Okay. So a building envelope refers to the exterior facade, which is comprised of both opaque components and fenestration. Opaque components include your walls, roof, etc. And the fenestration system includes windows, skylights, and doors. And even since if people get into these places, the house or the building will accumulate some heat, and even the person living in it will also radiate some heat. Hence, the ECBC depends on building occupation duration as well. Also, a table has been provided by ECBC. So, in the daytime, a U factor is given, and for a 24-hour occupancy, a U factor is given. This differs because in the daytime, both human will radiate out heat and the within the building envelope, and the building envelope will also take in some heat, whereas in night the building would radiate out heat, so there would be a different U factor, which would be a very average value. So what the EPF total is equals is basically EPF of roof, because it will have a different kind of solar radiation, EPF of wall, because it will have, where roof will get a very direct light, walls would be getting sometimes a direct light and sometimes diffuse light, and EPF fenestration, because roof and wall talks about your opaque components and fenestration talks about your transparent components. Okay, so let us see, EPF for a roof is C roof into sigma USAS, because your material for the roof would be different as well. So Sea roof refers to the coefficient of the roof class of construction. Okay, the material, it is a coefficient being given for the constructed material. Then you have a U factor of that material, as in the amount of heat it absorbs. And then you have the area, that is the area of the roof. So this information have been given in the ECBC, which is the envelope, which is the energy conservation building code. So this was the last question. As I told you, in every video we'll be discussing 10 to 12 questions. So this is it for today. Thank you for being there and patiently listening to me. Hope you understand it and read it well. I'll be linking down the link for the notes, the question papers and the answer in the description box below. Please do like, comment and subscribe to my channel Mahaguru Yash Architecture Classes. That's it for today. Signing off. This is Yash. Thank you.